Let's talk about modesty. Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. My name is Brittany Simon. In today's video, we're gonna talk about modesty because today we need to explore what it means to be modest in a modern world.
Why you shouldn't do OnlyFans.
Why in the world did you choose to save sex for marriage?
I am saving myself for marriage.
Within this conversation, in the context of this conversation, I'm mostly going to be focusing on women, but that's just because that's what I know. But this morning on my morning walk with my brother, I did ask him what modesty means to him. The way we mostly had the conversation was around the concept of the word in general, to be modest, to be private, to be withdrawn, to be conservative, to not be boisterous.
Every now and then, something will incite a debate about modesty in our culture. And this is an important thing because modesty is a good thing, and the reason we know that it's a good thing is because we all hate it when someone acts immodestly around us based on whatever standard of modesty we happen to uphold. We don't like it when others act arrogantly in proximity to ourselves. Nobody likes it when someone excessively boasts or brags or flagrantly tries to capture all the attention to be had for themselves, leaving none for the rest of us. Like, for example, nobody likes the person who always has the one-up story.
It's like this idea that it's kind of like a little bit of humility, modesty, and I think they're related, and so I think it's important that we cover it in sort of an open way. I think often, at least in America, when we have the word modest in a conversation, I think like the feministy, sex worker, positive person in me wants to like start getting ready for a fight.
And young women, please understand that if you dress immodestly, you are magnifying this problem by becoming pornography.
But I don't think that's necessary right now. I think we can have this conversation around this idea of modesty with an open mind. Okay, so grab your waters and let's get started. So the other day in the news, Lizzo was in controversy once again. And Lizzo reminds me of Madonna. People that I think are lovely in their own way, unique in their own way, obnoxious in their own way, and incredibly arrogant. They both kind of come off really needy to me and insecure. But at the same time, I don't blame them. Madonna for me was my generation's like sexual diva. She was somebody to me who, as a 9-year-old little girl, I remember thinking this is a beautiful woman. Let's just say 9-year-old Brittany got a lot of first experiences to images of Madonna, right? Like Madonna was the shit. And then Madonna was with Brittany at one point, and that was just like, like that was the lesbian iconic queer moment I was waiting for as a kid, and I got to see, and for me that was a big deal. And modesty was a conversation that always came up growing up, from Britney Spears at 16 years old to Christina Aguilera with her freaking flat ass tummy. You know, there's this trend happening that says millennials are people with money who get to now live and pay for the life they dreamed of when they were teenagers. I'm dressing in ways that my teenage self dreamed of dressing. Even as a child, I was hyper aware of my body and the power in imagery. I read a lot of fantasy and I watched a lot of documentaries, and I was hyper aware of what you could communicate with clothes.
So when I was younger, my mom used to let me dress myself. I used to be obsessed with wearing my turtlenecks at my waist like an apron. I don't know why. But I told my mom, I was like, this is a statement.
As I get older, I find myself more and more disconnected from my DDLG life, from any kind of daddy kinks. And it's so weird. But as I get older, I just have this mommy sort of toppy energy that's just coming over me as I age. And I love it. But it's so contradictory to what I imagine my life as, except in the ideal situation where I'm with a switchy bisexual man. It'd be so good. So I would argue about myself that I am just not modest. I'm not modest for my personality. I'm not modest in how I go about my day. My canter is not modest. My family hates that when I make statements, I just like matter of fact it. I put a period at the end. They want me to have humility. And I hear this from you guys as well, because some of you think I'm a narcissist. Obviously, I don't have the actual disorder, but I'm enough of a ego narcissist to think I deserve to be on YouTube and to be heard. I think my ideas are good enough, right? That's very common with people who want to be in the public eye, is that honestly, there are parts of us that really do think like, shit, I might have the answers. So I should probably share this, right? And now it's a spectrum, of course. Some people are just in it to be like, you know, worshipped, but I don't got time for that. So I'm a person that I think is immodest. I dress immodest. My attitude is immodest. Even when I was a child, I was immodest, meaning I didn't understand lines and boundaries and privacy, which could have been the borderline, to be honest. And I think it's also why people think I'm autistic, because they think that I'm acting out of social turn and therefore I'm not processing the social situation. But I actually think it's the opposite. If I had to compare myself to like people in anime, I am mischievous. There is a huge part of me that is just like a total brat, right? Like I have this toppy, very curious side of me, somebody who wants to explore and find the answers and kind of break the rules. I've talked about this a bazillion times. I've never been a person who quite understood why humans conscientiously limited themselves. When I was 4 or 5 years old, my mother said, I would go up to adults and ask them why. Why are you doing that? Why are you doing that thing? It's so strange to me, why are you doing that? And I still wonder that now. Why are you doing that? So I look at Lizzo, who's in the news, and Lizzo has this habit of, you know, I don't believe she quite likes herself. I think she's still struggling. My God. Oh, my God. Sorry, I had to take off my glove for this part because I cannot use my phone. So Lizzo was in the news because, once again, it came down to her body and the media and the bullying and how people treated her. She is a woman who is a bigger woman. She likes her body. She's very sexual. She's very immodest. And she's a person who wants to be that human right now. It's really important for her. And it seems important for her viewers. Some people really get inspired by Lizzo. And I'm going to tell you this right now. 22-year-old Brittany would have loved and needed Lizzo in the same way that 15-year-old Brittany needed Madonna. But 32-year-old Brittany has outgrown that stage of like needing to be loud and needing to make statements that are obnoxious and in ways that are obviously rebellious. Now, this is just how I dress. When I'm performing, when I'm in October-themed podcasts, when I'm having fun, this is like my cosplay Brittany or dressing up Brittany. But you guys know most of the time my default Brittany is a person who's definitely more dull than she's ever been. My previous self would have been like dressing up every day and wearing makeup and trying to be really like fashionable. And now my idea of fashionable is like hoodies and a sweat, like sweats, you know? And it's not to say that I'm better than anyone else. I'm just older. Like, Lizzo is young. Lizzo is doing exactly what I would be doing if I was Lizzo. And I did do it. I did it all the time. I was naked on Tumblr. I was going around. I just wasn't famous. I think so many people in their 20s are so promiscuous in ways that are immodest and are not even actual physical sexual experiences so much as being open and vulnerable on the internet. And for them, it does feel like their pockets of the world should feel safe. Because I feel that way sometimes on YouTube where I'm like, oh, I'm talking to the people on my channel who I know are amazing and eclectic and open. And I know that they're going to understand me and not think I'm some crazy person. But of course, then people who don't know me come on my channel and they view me and they go, oh my gosh, are you a narcissist? Because I'm a woman who knows what she wants and I put a period at the end of my sentences instead of a question mark. So my family, like you, gets frustrated that I make absolute statements. Instead, it seems people would like me to say, I think Lizzo isn't actually happy with her body. Maybe instead of, I don't think Lizzo's happy with her body. And this is funny to me. We talk about wanting independence. We talk about wanting to, you know, use our bodies to our advantages, whether it's through modesty and controlling men's urges or immodesty, riling up men's urges. And yet we can't even figure out when we're communicating with each other if we want women who end their sentences with a period or not, because it makes everyone seem uncomfortable. To be honest, there's a like, I'm a multifaceted person. So when I look at Beyonce and I look at the way she handled her issues with Jay-Z, you can tell Beyonce's in power. The point of power is in Beyonce. But Beyonce had a journey as much as Britney Spears or anyone else did, where she went from like teen idol to grown woman. When she became a mother, I was like, Beyonce's a mom. Like, I was impacted. Lemonade got me through my last relationship where I was cheated on. And I have never felt so, like, I just, that album was so good. Her visual album, so good. Moved me, stays with me. And I looked at her as a woman who was in power and as a woman who obviously wanted to also be somewhat submissive or a bottom to a man. I understand this, but that's the trope of being like the powerful woman trope. Vulnerability is allowing someone to do something, but then when you do it, what if you end up with a Jay-Z who cheats on you? It's like, oh my God, what? Excuse me, what? So then you go, well, who am I going to give it to you? Because I don't cheat. I'm not a cheater. I've never cheated. One of the most important things about my idea of power is that I follow and I live within my values. So if I cheated, it would be dishonorable. Not to be such a Gryffindor because I'm such a Slytherin, but it'd be dishonorable. And I'm trying really hard to live with honor. And I think that's really hard to convey in a world that is immodest. There's something about modesty that transcends just like our physical sexual output and is more about how we live our life. I think modesty is related to privacy, is related to trust, is related to pride, is related to community, I think all of these things coincide. So when we're looking at a Beyonce, you can tell she wanted something for her community. When you look at a Lizzo, you can tell she's doing something for herself. When you look at Rihanna, you can see that she's trying to dip her toes into both. Fenty is obviously a really good example of like an inclusion-based brand. Everything she's done with her lingerie brand, everything she's done with her makeup brand, you know what I'm saying? But it's still through the lens of capitalism, which is fine. We're not here to like demoralize money as it's a tool. We're here to like balance out where we are spiritually with our intake of income. I struggle with this. This is a huge deal for me as somebody who grew up lower middle class and somebody who makes a teacher salary currently. The idea of making more money, like an extreme amount more money, intimidates me. And at the same time, I know I'm a powerhouse. I know I'm a dominant woman. And I also know that I'm sensitive and I'm an empath. It's a really fine balance. Cardi, you can see herself immodest in a lot of ways. She's very open, very vulnerable. Cardi knows she's playing a role, and yet everyone knows she's playing a role. When she's on those late night shows, you know, everyone knows she's like the POC person, the brown person who's going to be funny and ooh, talk about ghetto stuff, and everyone's going to go ooh, and the white people in the audience are going to be like,
"You are from the Bronx?"
Mm-hmm. Ew.
Cardi.
Mi amor, nada más quería saludar.
Come on, I'm Dominican too.
Yeah, but do you see how I look?
You look beautiful.
Yeah, but,
you
know, by the
I
way,
don't look beautiful.
Hoy es el lanzamiento de tu nuevo tema press.
I know, but I have my daughter, I have my dad. I just don't look decent. I look how I look. Come on now, like you're a woman. No, like you come out and you look good with makeup. I don't look good. My hair's. Come on now, don't do that to me.
Okay, hold on.
I think Lana Del Rey is a great example of somebody who is so the system and so trying to be not about it, but she's failing time and time again. And I think it's because she doesn't have enough introspection. She lived in a bubble and I think continues to live in that bubble even though she's famous by who she hangs out with. And I'm just saying, when I look at Lana and I know she's looking for something more modest, more humility. Did you notice that Lana gained some weight and then Lana changed her vibe a little bit in her latest videos? Did you notice that there's something more modest? So one of you sent me this message that says, I have a video suggestion for you. There's a huge discussion about sexless movies or modern day purity culture and how a lot of millennials believe Gen Z is becoming very prudish when it comes to sex. I don't agree, but I'd love to hear your opinion on it if you'd like. This was what I was waiting for this podcast. I knew I was going to talk about modesty, but I didn't know how I was going to do it. I grew up religious like many of you, and I grew up with the idea that modesty was about the body and about privacy, what you tell people. And I was bad at boundaries with both. And so over time, I've gotten better. In conjunction with this message here, I have actually been following some statistics and they have been saying that Gen Z is becoming less LGBT friendly because it's inconvenient, which I agree with them. I can see that it's becoming very inconvenient to be a leftist or to have leftist values, even though they're good at heart. You know, everyone should be accepted and loved and live their life without persecution. It's not very useful if you're going around persecuting people so you don't get persecuted, right? It's just like, it's just silly. It's like we're going through a cycle. And then in conjunction, I've read that we're having less sex, which is very interesting. I myself haven't had sex since 2019. I am sexless and it's weird. Like I the other day thought to myself, I'm doing great. I'm working out. This sexless stuff is so fine. I'm a high drive woman. I'm great. I'm fine. Then I watched Squid Games and I saw Daddy slap a bitch and I almost died. I was like, oh my God. Like the masochist in me was like, holy shit, it has been so long. Oh my gosh. I'm not. It's a lot. Anyways, this isn't the point. The point is that I remember doing such cringy things to find out where my line was with modesty. And in my generation, it was all about sex. From American Pie movies to anything from that era, it was always about getting laid. It was about doing whatever you could to get partnered. So I was in a hypersexual kind of awakening time in my teen years, the 2000s. And then, of course, you know, just me being me, growing up in a conservative home who went more left, I wanted to experience everything. When I identified as a lesbian, because I didn't know bisexual was an option, I remember when I first wanted to have sex with a guy, I was like, I need to know what this is like before I die. There's just certain things I want to know what it is like before I die. And sex for me was something that I wanted to have control of. And so I was like a 22-year-old virgin, and I finally had sex, and it was great. But of course, then I got assaulted, which also makes sense according to my anime arc. Like, I think about my life and it's sort of like, how could you let that happen? How did you even get in this situation? And then, of course, like, I remember why I got in that situation. But I also remember that it wasn't even about my clothes. I know I wasn't assaulted because of what I was wearing. Like, I know all of those silly conservative talking points are only half true. Same with the left. It's like, people have to understand, when it comes down to victim blaming, there's really a difference between this thing that happened to you is literally your fault. And do you know, for the record, that human beings are predictable sometimes and we can prevent things from happening? Like, there really is a nuance there. And I know conservatives will say, well, you shouldn't have been at that party. And leftists will say, well, that rapist shouldn't have raped. Both are true, guys. Everything is true. Yes, I agree. Both of you are right. Both of you are right. In some ways, some people shouldn't be at parties, because parties are a congregation of people who often don't know each other. It can be dangerous if you're going to not consent-based parties, you know? I feel like we're all forgetting that human beings are really learning as we go. We just don't know things. For every person who comes to me and says, well, this is how the world should work, I say to them, yes, yes, but it doesn't. So now what? Because if you're stuck on the idea of how the world should work, you're going to get frustrated. So I actually think millennials fucked up with how obnoxious they were about their bullshit politics, that Gen Z is getting turned off because it's exhausted. We was born and raised in a very exhausting world. So many 19-year-olds I know, 20-year-olds, they're really asking themselves questions that my friends most certainly didn't ask themselves until later, or maybe certain friends ask themselves these questions, but they're wondering what the answer is, and they're so fucking lost because there's no one they can look up to, and so they're rejecting everything. So once again, we went from my mom's generation that was like modesty, modesty, then the 60s generation that questioned that modesty, then the 80s that was this dark rebellious time, the 90s, everything was just like, talk about psychedelic, bro. The colors, the pants, the everything was just hilarious. The 2000s with our midriff showing and our low rider jeans. Every generation fought each other. What's more modest? Everything became more fashionable. We compare today's teenagers to the teenagers in my time, and you can tell we've definitely changed. Things are different. Modesty is different. The way we describe what is modest is different. And so we just need to accept that things have changed and things are different. And right now, people don't want to be inconvenienced. And right now, if you push your bullshit down people's throat, demanding radical acceptance when you can't even radically accept people, you're going to have a backfire like you are with these Gen Z, because you all have been sloppy with your rebellion. The reason Madonna annoys me, or Lizzo, is because they think they're doing something original by being immodest. But immodesty is, you know, it's ancient. So it just feels a little silly to me, but also makes sense because they're in the world of the twos and these are their bubbles and these are the things people pay attention to and these are the headlines that make people talk. And so that's the irony, right? Is like, we're complaining that people aren't deeper or better, or why do they care so much about the body, but then they keep engaging in these conversations. I saw some people say that people just hate Lizzo because she's fat. I really do think people just hate Lizzo because she's annoying.
On Tuesday, the Grammy winner kept it real, like really real, on TikTok, posting a new video about her fitness routine and her self-love.
Hey, so I've been working out consistently for the last 5 years, and it may come as a surprise to some of y'all that I'm not working out to have your ideal body type. I'm working out to have my ideal body type. And you know what type that is? None of your business.
Normal. They happen to everybody. They happen to the best of us.
Lizzo closed her video with these inspirational words for her fans.
And I just have to know that tomorrow, how I feel in here is going to change. And I can only hope that it changes for the better. But I know I'm beautiful. I just don't feel it, but I know I'm going to get through it. I just started having all of these really negative thoughts about myself.
In a brutally honest selfie video, the 32-year-old singing sensation admits that she has been having body issues.
Like, you know, what's wrong with me? Maybe everything, all the mean things people say about me are true. And, you know, why am I so disgusting? And, hating my body.
It's the first time we've heard Lizzo talk this way. Baby, how you doing? The Grammy winner is famous for embracing her curves, often posting videos in skimpy lingerie. But now she's reminding her fans she's human too.
I think these are normal. They happen to everybody. They happen to the best of us.
Lizzo closed her video with these inspirational words for her fans.
And I just have to know that tomorrow, how I feel in here is going to change. And I can only hope that it changes for the better. But I know I'm beautiful. I just don't feel it. But I know I'm going to get through it.
Some people could hate her because she's fat. But those are like crazy people, right? Or in some way, like, conservative. Like, how could you hate someone because they're fat, really? Unless you have a real issue. That's the thing, is that I don't think fatness is necessarily traditionally attractive. I don't think it matters to me. I don't think it matters what I think. I think what matters is that we all have the bodies that make us feel comfortable and the ones we want to live in. This is your vessel for your consciousness. I don't care how you decorate it. So who cares what I think, or who cares what anyone thinks? The frustration comes from people who understand that weight loss and getting in shape and being healthy is so hard, that as an animal species evolved over time, obviously we have ideal ways to keep our form and our vessel, but ultimately, because we believe in free will and agency, bodily autonomy, people have the right to decorate their vessel how they want. I think it just sounds a little bit like Trisha Paytas when she says, "I'm proud to be fat," but then gets triggered when people point out her fatness or make fun of it. But I do see this trend of modesty becoming the new norm. I think, you know, now that smaller boobs are in and bigger hips are out, right? It's going away, though. I think modesty is coming back. One of my friends pointed out that apparently I'd been dressing more modest in the podcast or in the videos, and he thought I had done it deliberately. And I was like, no, what? I just get moods. Sometimes I'm like just like wanting to be naked and free. And then other days I do want to be covered up and snuggled. I want to be in a blanket of just like a tower of blankets so no one can see me. It's just so dependent on my mood. And so I think that's what will happen. I think modesty is going to come back in, and I think it's going to be interesting. Now, something I read that was sort of ironic to go along with this story was that Madonna's daughter recently came out and said that her mom was a control freak. And I thought to myself, oh, the irony for Madonna to go out there and be such a slut her whole fucking life, and then to be the thing that wants to cage her daughter from expressing herself. Isn't that ironic? Like, it is how it is, though, right? My mom was such a rebel. My mom was the first woman in her family ever to get a divorce, to ever leave home, to ever fall in love with, like, who she wanted to fall in love with. Because, you know, there was a lot of pressure to marry who you're going to marry. And there was a lot of drama. And so my mom's family, my dad's family, kind of, like, abandoned them for the first, like, 6 years of their marriage. And then finally everyone came back and it was fine. But it was, like, one of those things where my parents were both rebels for their own families. And then we're surprised when they gave birth to 9, 10 more rebels. Like, all 10 of their kids have some rebellious streak. All of us. We're just like, mm-hmm. We question everything. We ask why. We're not, you know, some of my siblings, you would argue, are modest, but most of them really aren't. The ones who are, they are. But most of us are very, you know, we're like very, we make a statement. We make it clear, like, we're not backing down. This movement with my hand is often like, this is, you know what I'm saying? And so, of course, people see that. And if you've never interacted with Middle Eastern people or never interacted with people who have like an insane amount of pride, it is just one of those things where, you know, we're not going to back down so easily. So I would argue modesty, from how we're dressing to how we're acting to how we're projecting, is all the same conversation in many ways. Because I grew up religious, I think often about the sexualization of like priests and nuns, and you guys know I got a priest in my life who's and we have good conversations, but I think about him and I told him I can't hug you. He is banned from hugging me because I can't hug him as anything but a woman. And because he's a priest and I respect his vows, we mostly high five. But every time we high five, it was like the spark of Jesus. It's like, oh my gosh. But how immodest is this conversation? Some would say it's blasphemy because I'm taking something that's so sacred from someone's religious belief and sexualizing it. Some people would say it's just immodest because it's me sharing like these fantasies about this forbidden thing, which we know then is lust, and lust is like immodest. But then when I spent time in the BDSM communities, it was so clear how religion was such a beautiful thing for a lot of us, but we fell out of it. And whether it was, you know, trauma-based or happy-based, a lot of us played around with our past religious selves through BDSM to find and have different intimate conversations with our bodies and our souls. Sounds super woo-woo, but trust me, there's something really powerful about kind of reliving like your little fantasies as you were a kid growing up or whatever your puberty time was, you know, I just remember having so many confessional fantasies. And there's something really safe about being able to recreate it as adults. Adults play pretend constantly. And this is one of the ways we play pretend, whether it's being a celebrity in which we put on a persona, or whether it's a YouTube persona, or whether or not it's that fantasy you have with your partners, negotiated hopefully, and there's consent involved. But you can explore different parts of yourself by playing pretend, no matter how old you are. You know what's crazy about the human body is how it's perceived so differently everywhere, right? You know how everyone is always having that realization that you're a person and everyone else is a person and we're all the main characters in our own stories? You know when you're on the freeway and you realize, oh my God, I'm in a car and my life is important and every car has a person whose life is as important as my life, and oh my gosh, right? You know how everybody's on their journey to introspection through introspection? So someone somewhere is having that realization right now. Right this second. But for many of us who have already had these realizations, we always ask ourselves, now what? So much of the content that's accessible in the world is for people just starting off on their journey. It's like we always spend so much time doing 101 stuff. It's like we don't take the time to finish the story. So I want my work to kind of reflect, now that I've given everyone the groundwork and all these podcasts to get here, let's really have a conversation about the literal nuance of the idea of the body, right? What is the body? What is it for? What's its functionality? There are so many reasons the body exists, and all of them are the correct reasons. And so we have to decide, in what moment in time are we existing? Like right now, my body is important as an objective piece, as a thing to observe, because it's setting a mood and a tone. I'm trying to convey something to you. I'm trying to literally convey something with the black, with the butterflies, with the hair, the way I'm sitting, the way my shoulders are. I'm trying to give a vibe and a message. I don't know what the subtext is. I don't even know if it's objective, but it's there. I know it's supposed to be there. I know I'm supposed to look like this today. But whatever you get from it is going to be whatever your subconscious has been thinking about. Remember, like, tarot is a tool to kind of trigger the subconscious into being more focused, like more in the forefront, more in the consciousness. It's like that. I'm here to subtly push an idea on you. This mug or this water bottle says, let the adventure begin. This, like, I put here for a reason. You know what I'm saying? I'm not trying to say I'm some mastermind, but I'm trying to say these are the things that I've noticed my whole life that stood out to me and made a difference. My whole life since I was a kid, all I did was watch a movie. And first, I focus on the characters, what I feel when I first watch it. The second time around, I always watch the background. What are people wearing? What are the shoe choices? Why did they put the light there? And then it goes on and on and on. Okay, every time I watch a movie, I try to focus on different things. Same with BDSM. When I went through BDSM, I treated it like a movie in layers. Oh, I do one flogging scene and I would focus on this thing. Second flogging scene, I would think about this thing. Third, I would think about this thing. I think it's like working out. When you're working out one muscle in like multiple ways, you're hitting different parts of the muscle. I want a full, well-rounded picture of my existence. I want all the details. I want to know that as a woman, for whatever reason, my body, when in certain contexts, interacts with other people, it can cause chaos or cheering, sadness, happiness, uncomfortableness. For whatever reason, the way we're perceived is so powerful in the minds of others, it can ruin someone's day. Our literal existence can ruin someone's day. And I know you know what I'm talking about, because all of us have experienced this. Whether it's a person you meet at the store who's rude, or somebody who shows up to an event in a way that you didn't expect, somebody who's been mean to you, somebody who's been good to you. We all know that person that ruins our day, and we are that person to somebody. And we have to decide, is that because we're bad, or is that because in contrast to other people's uniqueness, we will always be that someone to someone? This is the question about modesty that overlaps with everything we ever talk about. Modesty is a concept. You want to talk about a construct? Modesty. The Christians say that we were taught to be modest from our sin. It was a reaction to when Adam and Eve bit the apple. They realized they were naked and they realized that they had sinned. And their sin was shame. And so they had to cover up their shame, right? I think about that all the time, how the start of our existence, if you're religious and you're Christian at least, the idea is that our existence could have been great if it wasn't for this woman who ate this apple. This woman who is curious. This woman who was told, hey, I'm giving you everything. I am God, but here's this tree of knowledge. The reason I don't believe in a literal God is because I don't believe anyone who's ever had access to a literal God could betray them. I don't believe that Peter spent time with Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior and actually ditched that motherfucker for 3 days. I do not believe that Judas would be a servant of a God and then be like, I know better. Because this story sounds like every other story I've ever heard in any other religious context. Humans think they're smarter than gods. Humans do thing. God shows them that they are nothing. How do we all have the same theme and story around the world and yet claim to have the objective source? The difference between knowing and believing. Modesty is a construct, but it also plays a role in how we interact as like an animal species. But in order to pay respect to that, you have to acknowledge that we are without dehumanizing us. Even the ones I talk about in my level system that I call useless, they are still not yours to do what you want. You still can't go around killing ones, you freaking idiots. And that's the thing. How dare anybody question if whether or not I want to kill ones when you all are sitting there orchestrating the plan in your head? Look at you. I'm sitting here just explaining to you that some people are going to choose to be useless. And the automatic reaction your brain goes to is, now we should kill them. And I'm sitting here like, no, why would we do that? You want so badly for me to say a bad guy is somebody you should abandon and never talk to. But it's so contextual. The other day, my brothers and I were arguing over Hillary Clinton. They were like, do you like Hillary Clinton? Or something like that. And I was like, I don't like her or dislike her. I used to hate her. I used to like her. I voted for her. Then I hated her because she wasn't leftist enough. And then I became indifferent to her. If she's not in power, I don't care. Same with Trump. I only hate him when he's in office. Otherwise, I don't care. If either of them wanted to have a beer with me, I would. What does it fucking matter? We're all going to fucking die. We're all like literally worm food. What does it matter if I have a drink with them? You know what's funny, though? Is like some people would say, like, I would never have a beer with Trump, but I'll vote for Trump because he's the greater of two evils. Whatever, dude. Have a beer, don't have a beer, vote for him, don't vote for him. I didn't vote for Trump. I didn't vote for Biden. I'd have a beer with either of them. What does it matter? But I'm an immodest person. Some people would say, be dignified, be modest, stand by your values. But my values don't say I can't have a beer with somebody. I mean, honestly, if a serial killer, I could interview one in prison, I totally would. Hello? Oh my God. Is that just me? No, that's not just me. Come on. I know you guys are freaks. You like, how cool would that be to sit in a room with somebody and get to know them? I love humans. I think they're so interesting. Don't you? I guess not, though. I guess that's why people don't want to know these answers, because they're not actually interested in what it means to be a human. So they sit there and they create these arbitrary rules around modesty that in some contexts make total sense. For some reason, like I said, men, when they're around women in whatever context, but especially a little slutty, they switch some of them. Some of them don't. Some of them do. And we know that. Everybody knows that. Conservatives and leftists both agree. Everyone has the same paranoia around men being in women's bathrooms. Everyone has the same paranoia. But as a queer person who's been in like gender neutral bathrooms, who shared bathrooms with men, there are always going to be those men who are unlike the men that we're all afraid of. Some people would argue it's straight men that are actually everyone's fear. But we also know that sexual abuse happens in queer communities, and we can't ignore that. But I get the vibe, because in my instant, like in my life, queer people have been better equipped to handle immodesty. But they're not perfect. None of us are. None of us are perfect. So again, when I look at my notes, you know, I'm looking at context, anime, religion, kinks. Some people aren't watching animes because there's incest or weird age dynamics. Like, guys, I think I'm just an immodest person because I do not give a fuck. I don't care how deep or raunchy or dark the fantasy is. I want to know. I want to see the details. I just want to get into the minds of humans. If humans were crazy enough to create it, I kind of want to see it. I've seen a lot of weird things in my life, and my friends were so weird growing up. I mean, talk about immodest. We would prank each other by sending each other porn links. No warning. Just fun porn links on our phone or on our computer and be like, ah, ha, ha, ha. And it was our way of being hilarious. You know how many weird bestiality videos I've seen because my friends have happily sent me links? I don't know what to tell you. The world is crazy and layered. And so if you sit here and think that the world is some, I don't know, Polly Pocket world, you're crazy. But if you also think it's all hell and awful and people are always killing each other, that's crazy. It's all of it. It's all of the contexts. So modesty is so subjective, as is everything else we do. How can we not be in conflict with one another and what it means to be modest? I look at myself and I don't feel modest right now, but I don't feel very inappropriate either. Everything is covered that needs to be covered. I'm going to be able to put this outfit on Instagram. So for me, in some ways, I'm like, oh, I'm in a sexy, kinky outfit or like a bikini sort of, but not. And at the same time, I know that's not true. I know there's something about the blackness, the polyester, which is supposed to look like leather, the imagery of the gloves. I know all of that is supposed to send messages of dominant, sadist woman, mommy, you know, whatever it might send to your brains. It's not supposed to send meek or cute or adorable or not safe. It's supposed to send maybe dangerous. You know what I mean? This water bottle maybe sends cute and fluffy and less dangerous. But, you know, maybe this pumpkin balances it out, or maybe this one here. We're all trying to send each other different messages. And I'm just curious if we can decipher maybe what they are so we're not so chaotic when we don't understand them. Maybe we can go into it knowing we're not going to understand because it's someone else with a different bubble. That's what I'm trying to get at, I think, with the levels, is I'm trying to get people to understand, if you know people are living and coming from bubbles and interacting with you, you're able to handle it so much better. You're able to start growing into a space where as you age, you can be more modest, be more private, where you don't feel a need to be rebellious, where you feel a need to kind of dress up on occasion, right? But you don't feel that obligation to go out with a full face of makeup or appeal to the masses or appeal to your community, but you know how to live within your community's confines. Being modest can be anything from embracing the fact that you don't want to show off your body to hold power. Like, I've heard some Muslim girls make this argument that they hold the power because they decide when and who sees their bodies. And then at the same time, I think you can hold power by being able to be immodest, by flaunting your body, by holding it high and saying, this is mine, this is my vessel, holding my consciousness, and I'm going to dictate how it's presented and not even received, really, because that's really up to the receiver. But in general, there's a power there as well. I know that my personality type and the kind of women that I represent is not everyone's cup of tea. And I know every single one of us is going to see different women as powerful. Every single one of us are going to find different ways to find mentors or people that we respect. But if I've learned anything about existence, but the most important one I learned is that it's okay that not everyone is for you. There are so many amazing content creators on YouTube that are being ignored because they don't fit the niche. And so many, you know, so many movies are waiting to be watched. So many songs are waiting to be heard because they're not mainstream and people are ignoring them. And there's also a lot of good coming from the mainstream. And there's a lot of bad. But not all of it is directed for us or is about us. And I think when you start acknowledging where you exist in relation to existence, you're going to find out that modesty is a game to some people. It's a conveyor of emotions. It's a matter of efficiency. It's also something that's convoluted and something that's sacred. It's all of the things. But what does it mean to be modest in a world that is constantly begging you to be immodest? And that's why I think the new power will be modesty. Why do you think everyone's having this cute obsession with offline boyfriends? My boyfriend's not on the internet. None of his stuff's on the internet. It's going to be the new power move. Girls and guys, people who are more conservative, but not conservative politically, because that's going away, just in nature, and people won't know what to do with them. But that's the cycle, right? Immodest, modest, immodest, modest, immodest, modest. War, peace, good times, bad times. We're just in another cycle. And when you start to focus on the cycles and you start to learn them, the future becomes a little bit more predictable, but never completely. But then you can plan, like I do for future Brittany's sake. I'm trying to do everything I can now so she can have options in the future in case she changes her mind and wants to do something else. But as of right now, I'm heading in a direction. And I am going to do so immodestly because that's just who I am. But that doesn't mean that's who you have to be. If you want to be modest, be modest. If you want to explore immodesty, do it. But every single action has a consequence. So make sure to follow your joy. Your joy is the answer. Always, 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 always the answer. Follow your joy. And the right answer will come about. Okay, guys, I hope you enjoyed this week's podcast. Thank you for watching. Have the most fantastic day. And I'll see you next weekend. Or next week. Next weekend? Next week. Next week. Okay, bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life while I'm in bed, my belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind. cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed. So why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking. Yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth. And living life is a fool.